Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. What an honor to be in the Lord's house tonight. It's each and every one of you here. We want to look to the Lord and go to the Lord in prayer. Still feasting on yesterday. Praise the Lord. But how many of you know that when you eat, how many of you know you, how many get in here after you eat a meal about, I'd say maybe 6 hours later? Anybody in here get hungry again? Well, I know you're nodding your head at me. Come on, do like this a little bit at me. Anybody get hungry again? Well, now, what do? You go eat again. Well, you know, yesterday was wonderful. God just blessed us in a special way. But I come back tonight. I want to see the Lord. I come back for feeding time. Help me here tonight. Feast feeding time. Hallelujah. I believe the Lord's got some feed for us. Let's pray together. Our gracious Heavenly Father, we come before you thanking you for your goodness to us, your blessings, your love, your mercy that you so graciously bestowed upon us today, giving us another privilege and an opportunity to gather back, Lord, in this sanctuary here tonight. Lord, we come to lift up and to exalt and to magnify the only one whereby men can be saved. Touch us here tonight that no one can leave in the same manner. Lord, whatever the needs are, somebody needs to be saved. I pray, Lord, before this service is over, Lord, they'll be brought to a realization, dear God, as that prodigal son that was in that hog pen and he saw his need for you. He'll come home, sanctify, filled with the Holy Ghost. May somebody taste the good word of God and the powers of the world to come. We'll give you praise for all that's accomplished and done in Christ's holy name. Amen and amen. Have several ministers here with us tonight. We're just delighted to have you with us. Brother Dean is with us all the way from the big city of Roanoke Rapids up there. Amen. We're thankful to have him here with us tonight. Others that are here. Brother Hunt is here. But he didn't have to come quite as far, but it's at least, you know. Tell me, if you have your hymn book, turn to number 248, singing along with us just over in the glory land. Amen, amen. Let's sing it together.
I've a home prepared where the saints abide, just over in the glory land. And I long to be by my Savior's side, just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land, I'll join the happy angel band, just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land, there with the mighty host I'll stand, just over in the glory land. I am on my way to those mansions fair, just over in the glory land, there to sing God's praise and his glory share, just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land, I'll join the happy angel band, just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land, there with the mighty host I'll stand, just over in the glory land. What a joyful thought that my Lord I'll see, just over in the glory land. And with kindred say, there forever be, just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land, I'll join the happy angel band, just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land. just over in the glory land. With the blood washed on, I will shout and sing, just over in the glory land. And Hosanna to Christ the Lord and King, just over in the glory land. Just over in the glory land, I'll join the happy angel band. Just over in the glory land, just over in the glory land, there with the mighty host I'll stand. Just over in the, let's sing verse 3 one more time. What a joyful moment. Just over in the glory land, and with kindred say, there forever be. Just over in the glory land, just over in the glory land, I'll join the happy angel band. Just over in the glory land, just over in the glory land, there with the mighty host I'll stand. Just over in the glory land. Hallelujah. Oh, I am blessed. I am blessed. Every day that I live, I am blessed. Anybody blessed tonight? When I wake up in the morning, till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed. Oh, I am. Somebody help me bless him tonight. Oh, I am blessed. I am blessed. Oh, every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning, till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed. I am blessed. One more time. Oh, I am blessed. Hallelujah. I am blessed. Oh, every day that I live, I am blessed. When I wake up in the morning, till I lay my head to rest, I am blessed. I am blessed. Before you're seated tonight, turn around and look at somebody and say, we're so glad to have you here on Monday night, revival night. God bless you so much. Praise the Lord. What an honor to have, what an honor to have all of you here tonight. Good to have our district overseer, Brother Edwards. He's sitting back there kind of in the runway tonight. Amen. Brother Donnie Honeycutt's here tonight, all the way from Old Mill. You know, I remember him when he was younger than what he is now. Amen. We had the honor of pastoring him and his dad and those precious people down at Old Mill. They're up here doing music here for us. Sister Rihanna's going to be singing in just a moment. And then Sister Dean's coming around and doing a special, so we're just doing one tonight. We want Brother Jimmy Jones to have plenty of time to lay it out. I'm telling you, he laid it out last night, and I don't know where my hip got out of joint last night, but praise the Lord, hallelujah. But I tell you, when he got through, I was willing for it to be. Amen. Come on, help me here tonight. I don't know about you, I want him to touch me. Yeah. I want him to touch me, praise God, because I tell you, when he touches you, you'll never be the same. never be the same. We want to go to the Lord in prayer, take your request before Him. Maybe you have an uplifted hand request you'd like to just signify. Want to continue to remember Sister Barbara Murphy. Her dad passed away. Remember that family, and that the Lord would minister to them. Sister Odessa Barber, we're still believing God for her. God has touched her to some degree, and we're just thankful, and I want to see God continue to touch her. Anyone else might have a request before we go to prayer? Amen. The Lord knows about that need tonight. Amen. Yes, yes. Yes. I'd like to remember a young man I sung with in a group way back when I was pretty young. Randy Warren lost his brother. Forgot what his name. Wilmer. And lost his brother, and I'd like to pray for them, God, that family. Anyone else? Yes, Brother Andrew. Yes. And let's really be much in prayer for our nation. We don't know what tomorrow holds, but we know who holds tomorrow. Amen. Praise the Lord. Anyone else? Amen. Brother Edwards, honor to have you tonight. Would you lead us to the Lord in prayer? Gracious Heavenly Father, as we come before you tonight, we thank you, Lord, for your blessings you so graciously bestowed upon us. We thank you, Lord, for the privilege tonight that you've given unto us to be gathered into the house of God, asking you, Lord, to touch, Lord, each one of these requests that were given in tonight. Lord, of those needs, Sister Brenda Stone that spoke about that need tonight, I pray for that need and pray that you would, Lord, minister to that need tonight in that special way. We pray for Sister Odessa Barber. We're believing you, Lord, for healing, Lord, in her body, that you would touch her, Lord, and bring healing to her. You're greater than cancer. You're greater, Lord, no matter what kind that it may be in the body. My God is greater. I pray, Lord Jesus, for Lord Sister Barbara Murphy, the family, Brother Tommy Holmes, Sister Joanne, Lord, and Reuben. We pray, dear God, Lord, that you would minister to them. Also, Lord, for the loss of her brother, minister to the family, Lord, we pray. Touch them, Lord. We pray for Bobby Holmes and asking you to minister to him. All of those, Lord, part of that family, those grandchildren and all, we thank you. We pray for every uplifting hand request as it went up in this place tonight that you will minister to that need. Oh, God, touch them, Lord. We pray and that not one will be able to leave in the same manner in which they've come tonight, saved, sanctified, filled with the Holy Ghost and with fire. And we'll give you all the praise and glory and honor for those things that will be accomplished in this service tonight. But Lord, it's in your holy name. Save somebody in this service. Sanctify, Lord, we pray. Lord, we pray that not one will be able to leave in the same manner in which they've come. Touch them, Lord, we pray. Thank you, Lord Jesus. I come, Lord Jesus, tonight, Lord, in feeding time. And Lord, Lord, just anticipating on what, Lord, the feed that you have for us tonight. I'll give you praise for it all in Jesus' name. Everybody said amen, amen. So good to have Sister Brother Donnie and Sister Rihanna with us. They're coming around to sing, so worship with them as they sing. And after they sing, Sister Juanita Dean is coming around, and she's going to be singing, so worship with them tonight.
Amen. I want to say that it's so good to be in the house of the Lord here tonight. I look forward to hearing tonight what the Lord has to say. Amen. We thank God for the music. We thank God for the altar service, you know, but I want to hear from the Lord tonight, what the Lord has to say. So I look forward to hearing from this brother tonight. And, you know, I was thinking about this scripture here. There in John, it says, "Let not your heart be troubled. You believe in God, believe also in me. In my Father's house are many mansions. If it were not so, I would have told you. I go to prepare a place for you. And if I go and prepare a place for you, I will come again and receive you unto myself, that where I am, there you may be also." And I thank God tonight for that hope. You know, the world does not have that hope tonight. There's a lot going on And if, you know, they didn't have the Lord, it's enough to just drive anybody crazy. But I thank God tonight for the peace of God. I thank God for the hope that we have. And they can have that hope, amen. And I just pray that they will before it's eternally too late. But we just want to sing this song tonight, and we just pray that you will just worship the Lord, and let's just draw our minds into Him and prepare our hearts to receive His word tonight. Amen. The Lord gave us a promise that keeps us pressing onward. Jesus said He's coming back.
Over the moment He appears. So your head, he's almost here. All our battles will be over the moment he appears. Soldier, lift your head, he's almost here.
Thank you, Lord.
That don't light your fire, your wood's wet.
Are you ready to go to that city?
Amen. I'm going to a city, there'll be no more night. I'm going to a city, Jesus is the light. The trumpet's gonna sound and I'll be called away. I'm going to a city someday, yes I am. I'm going to a city, there'll be no more to a city, Jesus is the light. The trumpet's gonna sound and I'll be called away. I'm going to a city someday. All the trials that I've known down here will all be over. No more doubt, no more fear. I'm gonna see my loved ones who've gone on before. And with Jesus as my Savior, I'm gonna live forevermore. I'm going to a city, there'll be no more night. I'm going to a city, my Jesus is the light. The trumpet's gonna sound and I'll be called away. I'm going to a city someday. There'll be no crying when I get up there. No more sadness, no more burdens to bear. There'll be no sickness, ain't gonna be no more pain. And best of all, I'm gonna see Jesus, who call me by my name. I'm going to a city, there'll be no more night. I'm going to a city, Jesus is the light. Oh, the trumpet's gonna sound and I'll be called away. I'm going to a city someday. Yeah, I'm going to a city, there'll be no more night. I'm going to a city where Jesus is the light. Trumpet's gonna sound and I'll be called away. I'm going to a city someday. Oh, let me tell you, won't it be wonderful there? Having no burdens to bear. Trumpet's gonna sound and I'll be called away. I'm going to a city someday. Oh, the trumpet's gonna sound and I'll be called away. I'm going to a city someday. Yeah, the trumpet's gonna sound and I'll be called away. I'm going to a city someday.
Hallelujah, I'm going to a city. I know a man who saw it. John the Revelator saw it coming down out of heaven. Hallelujah, praise God. What a city, what a city. Now, if God created the earth, and I believe it did, in 6 days, and he's been gone 2,000 years, wow, what a city that's going to be. Wow. I believe it's already finished. Hallelujah. Praise the Lord. What an honor to have each and every one of you here tonight. God bless you for coming. I don't believe you're going to be disappointed if you come and you put something other in it. Now, before I turn it over to Brother Jimmy, there's a little boy standing inside of his daddy, and when the offering plate came by, so I'll remind you there, we got an offering plate that's out there, and when you go out, it's over there on the table on the left, so don't forget. It's on my left. Where's it at? On the left. And just drop it in there. There'll be some ushers out there if you happen to leave before then. But that little boy standing inside of his daddy, and his daddy put a quarter in the offering. And when the service was over, they went out. His dad looked down at the little boy and said, you know, it won't too much tonight. The little boy said, but you didn't put much in. Brother Jimmy.
Brother Clendenin said when he was a kid, his daddy took him to the county seat for the first time he ever went. He's on his daddy's shoulders, and he couldn't believe all that he was seeing. And he said to his daddy, he said, Papa, if the world's as big the other way as it is this way, we'll never see all this. And he wound up traveling to almost 60 countries of the world before he died at the age of 87. When I was a teenage boy, come from a poor family, I thought when I was riding with a friend of mine in an 18-wheeler hauling livestock, when we went through Charlotte, I thought I'd seen a city. In 1989, when I drove into Baltimore for the first time in my life to conduct revival, I thought I'd seen a city. 1990. Flew into San Antonio, Texas. At the end of the week, I thought I'd seen a city. Flew into Port of Spain, Trinidad, 1993. I thought I'd seen a city. But you know, after about 58 years on this planet, I've decided I ain't seen no city yet. I'm going to a city. Somebody said it's 1,500 miles long. Now, folks, that's a city. Tree's going to bear fruit every month. That's a city. Brother Kenny Morris said the banana's going to be as big as his leg. That's a city. Glad you're in the house of the Lord tonight. I asked for a show of hands. The preachers last night, probably 12 to 15 folks raised their hands. I'm almost afraid to do that tonight. We might have, going to feel like a preacher's convention again. But how many preachers are in the house? Raise your hand all over the place. So glad you're in the, almost as many. Glad you're in the house of the Lord with us tonight. Blessed by the singing and the music. Blessed by your presence. I'm just glad to be numbered among you tonight on some ordinary day, just like this Monday. Jesus is going to come again. Hallelujah. The week that I was saved on Thursday night of that week, They sang this song a number of times that week. I don't want to get adjusted to this world. Got a home that's so much better, I'm going to go to sooner or later. I don't want to get adjusted to this world. Genesis chapter 3. Have your Bibles tonight. Not my intent to be long-winded. Just preach till I get finished. When I was a young preacher, I read where somebody said that a good message ought to be composed of a good beginning and a good ending, and don't let them be too far apart. Well, I'll try to adhere to that tonight. It is a delight to have our this area's district overseer, Brother Edwards, House of the Lord. Appreciate leadership in our day that holds to the line. I appreciate him. Good to see great friends, the deans. There are other folks here, but Brother Larry Hunt's a very, very dear friend. I appreciate him. Last week I served on a funeral, and it was hard to make that transition from that funeral to revival again that night. He just preached a funeral of a member of his, and he's in revival. I don't know how difficult it is for him to make the transition. I hope it's not difficult at all. But it took me a little while that afternoon after burying a friend's mom just to shake that feeling of that funeral. But I want us to have resurrection power in this house tonight, don't you? Hallelujah. Good to see the McClendons again. The book of Genesis chapter 3, verse 6, the Bible says the following. And when the woman saw that the tree was good for food, and that it was pleasant to the eyes, and a tree to be desired to make one wise, she took of the fruit thereof and did eat. The last portion of this verse breaks my heart. And gave also unto her husband with her, last four words, and he did eat. And he did eat. For the next little while, I'm going to preach to you on this thought simply. He refused to abandon his bride. Now, y'all so quiet. He refused to abandon his bride. May it please the Almighty to help us preach. You might be seated. Sit down. By all means, be seated. Make yourselves comfortable, but please don't sit down on me. Help me for the next little while. I said to this congregation that was here yesterday morning, because I was in a revival not long ago, and an old sister said this. She said, we don't know how many more times we'll be able to gather like this to have a revival. So I said to yesterday morning's congregation, I'll covenant with you that I'll preach this week like it's my last time preaching a revival, if you will worship like it's your last time worshiping in revival. How many would join me in that tonight? Listen, folks, it could be. It could be. If you will go with me for the next little while, he refused to abandon his bride. I noticed last night that the pastor talked about his bride. I think he said 42 years ago. Is that right? He said when he was standing there and they opened that door, and his bride walked through that door to come up to that altar. He looked at her, and I'm sure there wasn't anything in this world he wouldn't have done for that bride. Preached for a friend last week, and they celebrated their 47th wedding anniversary. And he said, I'm going to give you 1 minute to tell these people about me. He said, but you don't have time to tell them all the good, so don't try to tell them good. But I said, don't tell them any of the bad. She stood up and said, I don't have anything to say. He took everything away from me. But what wouldn't a groom do for that beautiful bride? In Adam's case, Somebody said one time years ago that he may have been in that, or they may have been in that garden 300 years before they sinned, before they fell. Man from the Lumberton area said, I don't believe it was that long. He referred me to a verse of scripture and he said, I don't think they were in that garden but about 120 years. Well, I'm going to tell you something, folks, I wouldn't turn around for the difference because there was no sin. And Eve looked as good 120 years to 300 years after God presented her to Adam as she did the day he presented her. So what wouldn't that groom do for that bride? At the heart of my message is this truth that Adam refused to abandon his bride. Abraham would have lost his bride to Abimelech, the king of Gerar, were it not for God. He would have abandoned that woman, that bride, to her. They had left Ur the Chaldees together so many years ago. They'd been through so much over the years hoping for a son that had not yet come, a son that God had promised and had not yet produced. And now, a year away from the time that boy is supposed to arrive, the king of Gerar, Abimelech, took her. Abraham would have lost her altogether except for God. Abimelech went to bed that night and God said, you're a dead man. I'm going to kill you. Don't everybody shout one time. Said, that man, that woman belongs to a man. That man belongs to me. And if you touch her, I'm going to kill you. Abraham would have forfeited his bride except for God. Some years later, Isaac would have forfeited his bride to Gerar, the king, or Abimelech, rather, the king of Gerar. He would have forfeited his bride to that king. But one day, the king looked out a window, and the Bible says that he was sporting with his wife. And the king said, there's more to that than just a brother-sister relationship. So he called him in and said, you said that's your sister, but I'm telling you she's more than that. He would have forfeited his bride. You know the reason Abraham and Isaac would have forfeited their bride? Because they were afraid that the king would have killed them just to get their bride. Their brides were so beautiful in their eyes, and apparently they'd heard other people mention the beauty of their wives, their brides, until they would have forfeited those brides because they were afraid of dying for them. Joseph would have abandoned his bride in Nazareth had it not been that one night he went to bed and the angel of the Lord spoke to him in a dream and said, fear not to take unto you Mary, thy wife. He said, that holy thing that's inside her, he said, that's of God. The Holy Ghost has done this. Ain't no Roman soldier touched that girl. She's as pure as when she made her promise. Do you shout with me, somebody? He would have forfeited his bride had it not been for the angel of the Lord. Now, Clint Brown, I don't know if he wrote the song. I assume that he did. He sings it like he wrote it. But he sings this song that's titled, If Not for Grace. And in that song, there is a line where it's as though he's talking to God. And he said, you could have walked away, but you stayed 1,000 times. How many of you over the span of time you've walked with God, how many times, looking back over the years, could he have walked away? I said, how many times could he have walked away? How many times should he have walked away? But he stayed 1,000 times, my Lord. I said he stayed 1,000 times. Been a lot of mornings we woke up and he should have been gone, but he stayed. Shout with me. How many times in your marriage, ladies and gentlemen, have you thought they could have walked away, but they stayed 1,000 times? I came by to tell you there's somebody that sticks closer than a brother, and God doesn't trade his bride in every 6 months. Glory to God forever and ever. Could have walked away, but he stayed 1,000 times. Now, it has been said of that first couple that an aura or a light clothed them or surrounded them. I'm not preaching that as Bible, but I cannot disprove it. But there are those who believe that when God breathed into Adam's nostrils the breath of life and he became a living soul, that this light clothed him. And when God put him to sleep and took a rib and made Eve, presented her to him, that the two of them were clothed with the light. They were naked except for the light, but they didn't know they were naked. They were naked and not ashamed. If that is so, I don't know. I'm not questioning it. But if it's so that they were clothed with the light, then that light was on when the serpent came to talk to Eve the first time. Now, I don't think that recorded conversation in Genesis 3 was the first time they'd ever spoken. I don't think that's the first time that the serpent had ever accosted Eve in that garden. But if they were in fact clothed with a light, when the serpent came to Eve the first time, the light was on. When he came to speak to her the last time, the light was on. When the conversation with her was over, the light was on. When she walked over to the tree of knowledge of good and evil, the light was on. When she plucked that fruit, the light was on, my opinion. When she bit it and chewed it up, the light was on. But as soon as she swallowed, the light went out. Shout with me, somebody. That had not been the case in 120 years to maybe 300, whatever you believe, however you believe about the length of time that they were in that garden. But the light had gone out. The light then was off, had to be, when she approached Adam, her husband. Now Adam looked up and saw a few things. First of all, he saw that his light was out, if in fact what I've said is true. He saw that her light was out. The second thing he saw is she's coming toward him. And the third thing he saw was she's carrying fruit. She's carrying forbidden fruit. I was thinking about this not long ago, and I wondered, is it possible that early on in that garden when Eve had sinned so long ago, is it possible that when she was coming to Adam, when Satan knew her light was out and Adam would surely recognize that, I wondered, did he clothe her with a light that was not divine? A light of deceit. He was and is the angel, the original angel of light. Is it possible that he tried to camouflage her in a light that did not belong to God? I don't know. I just know this, that Adam had been with her long enough and had walked with God often enough that Adam knew something is wrong. That light being out screamed to Adam, something is out of place here. Something is wrong. If Adam saw that the light was out, and I'm convinced that he did, why would Adam take forbidden fruit from his bride and eat it? Why would he? If he can look at her and tell the results of having eaten that fruit, and he watched it while she approached him, he knew where that fruit came from, why would Adam eat that forbidden fruit when he knew the light was out? But let me ask you this, why would he eat of that fruit if even especially because God had said, thou shalt not eat of it? Now, I think the church world is full of folks. They saw a person's light was out, and they offered them something forbidden. They do like Adam. They take it. They'd eat it. But let me tell you what's worse than that. There are folks that if Eve walked up, her light is still on, but she's got forbidden fruit in her hand, and she offers it for them to eat. They'd eat it. Y'all kind of quiet. That makes a man nervous. Kind of lonely up here. The question is, why would Adam eat that fruit? Her light's out, and he knows it's forbidden. And he sees what happened to her will surely happen to me. The answer is really simple. Because the man would not abandon his bride. I know we're living in a day when people have militantly charged the sexes so that people argue over gender. Folks who say the best man for the job is a woman. That sets men on edge. And men start talking about how weak women are. And women get mad. That won't ever the will of God. I said that won't ever the will of God. That folks would argue over gender. Adam didn't argue because God brought him a woman. I'm just glad God didn't bring him a man. Shout with me, somebody. What I'm telling you. It's been so charged until it creates a fight. But let me tell you what they told me when I was a young preacher. My wife and I going through that internship program, she wouldn't attend all of it because she was pregnant with our middle son, and they would excuse her for not attending. But they said to me and her, matter of fact, they said to every intern, they said, your wife can make or break your ministry. Doesn't matter how anointed you are, how great you can preach, how brilliant your mind, said your wife can make or break your ministry. Anybody hear what I'm saying? Listen, folks, there's something to be said for that. But we must be on guard. We must not so love our spouse that we violate the will of God just to make a spouse happy. Shout with me, somebody. I know there's some young preachers in this house tonight. I want to say to you, young preacher, don't marry just anybody. Find somebody that compliments your belief. Find somebody that believes the way you believe. If you don't, the day will come you'll have to choose whether to eat that forbidden fruit or not. That's right. That's right. I could chase a rabbit here, but he ain't jumped up. Move on. Well, the reason Adam did that is because he simply wouldn't abandon his bride. He would not. He looked at Eve, and I'm telling you, folks, 1,000 thoughts must have gone through his mind. But Adam would not abandon her. Adam had said, when God presented her to him, he said, this is flesh of my flesh and bone of my bone. That may have been 120 years ago, but nothing's changed. I'm telling you, folks, he still loves her, and he absolutely, flat-footedly refused to abandon her. He would fall, and he did fall with her rather than abandon her. He would suffer and did suffer the same fate that she had suffered rather than abandon her. There are people in their Christian homes, their ministries tonight that have been ruined because folks chose to follow the flesh rather than to follow the will of God. Shout with me, somebody.
Shout with me, somebody. He'd rather suffer her fate than to abandon her to her fate. They had become one in sin, and they were thrown out of the garden to the loathing of their persons. Just as they had become one in the bliss of the garden, they became one in the sin that ejected them from that garden and separated them from the fellowship of God Almighty, who would come down every day just to walk with them. The first Adam, that first Adam sunk down into the depths of depravity with his bride. Didn't nobody push him over the edge? Didn't nobody pull him over the edge? He stepped out over the edge. Adam is guilty of leaping into that depravity with Eve. Like the captain of the Titanic, Adam went down with the ship. Captain Edward J. Smith went down with his ship during the sinking of the Titanic. This phrase, the captain goes down with the ship, is a maritime tradition that a sea captain holds ultimate responsibility both for the ship and everyone that embarked on it. And in an emergency, he will either save them or he'll die trying. Adam went down with the ship, but he neither saved Eve, neither did he try. I'll have to get to this later, because I might forget it. In time, there'll come another Adam. I'm telling you, that captain went down with the ship, and he was determined. He was determined, I'll save him, or I'll die trying. He did both. He died to save him. Somebody shout with me. I said he died to save him. Adam could not save her. Adam, from where he was, could not lift her before he fell, after he fell. He could not lift her. He could not reverse the curse. He could not turn that thing around. He couldn't undo the fact that she swallowed that fruit, bitten that fruit, plucked that fruit, and believed that serpent. He could not reverse the curse. He couldn't undo all of that. He could not turn her light back on. Absolutely futile even to attempt it. I'm convinced that Adam would have shed his blood to save her. Now, after all, that's how he got her. She had come to him through his blood. It was his blood that had brought his bride to him. She came through the blood of that first Adam. But I'm telling you, Adam couldn't save his bride. He wouldn't abandon her. But then he couldn't save her. Adam couldn't save her before he bit that fruit and swallowed it. He couldn't save her after his failure and disobedience. After that had happened, and there's no way for either of them to get up, God does something absolutely startling. God comes to that garden, even though he knows Adam and Eve have both sinned. He knows the lights have gone out in their lives. But God came into that garden and God showed them something he had never showed them in a century or two or three. God showed up in that garden and he showed them sacrifice. Now all this is, ladies and gentlemen, is a preview of a coming attraction. It says to Eve, you are not unlike a coming bride. It said to Adam there's coming another who'll be able to do what you could not do. There'll be some differences in you, but God showed them sacrifice. All sacrifice is one selected to die for another. I don't know how many animals were in that garden, but God Almighty looked over that garden until he found the right one. This one will do. Rest of you can shout when you get to the house. He chose that animal. We don't know what kind. We do know this. It was an animal full of blood. Sacrifice. One dying in the place of another. The other thing that God showed him was blood. Innocent blood. Paying the penalty for guilty blood. And God slew the animal, and the blood ran out on the ground. God didn't just show them sacrifice. He didn't just show them blood. He showed them it had to be a different kind of blood from yours. It's got to be a special kind of blood. Don't everybody shout it one time. In the Garden of Eden, it was innocent animal blood. That blood was not perfect. But in the eyes of God, it'll do until that which is perfect gets here. I'm telling you, on Golgotha, on that skull-shaped hill, it wasn't animal blood. It wasn't the blood of bulls or goats or pigeons, folks. It was innocent, divine, human blood shed on the cross. It took a special blood. It took a different blood. Somebody shout amen with me. If you follow the history, Adam fell with Eve. You watch the trail of depravity. Their own son would murder his brother. Abel would be slain by his brother, killed in a field, left for the vultures. God would say, where's your brother? He'd lie to God, say, I don't know. Am I my brother's keeper? God said, whatever you are, I hear your brother's blood crying to me from the ground. Adam and Eve watched that. It happened because of what they did in that garden. It got worse, folks. Men started burning in their desire for men. And women burned in their desire for women. I'm telling you that the depravity got so bad that God in heaven said, I wish I'd never made man. I repent that I ever made man on the earth. One day God had a belly full. He said, I know what I'll do. He said, I'll destroy every living thing with the earth. Shout with me, somebody. Listen, folks, if you follow that, if you follow it through that flood, if you follow it all the way to 2021, since 1973, between 60 million and 70 million babies have been aborted in America alone. That's just the recorded ones. I said, that's just the recorded ones. I read the other day that 40 million babies worldwide were aborted in 2020. Somebody ought to help me preach a little bit. If you can trace it back to the garden. You know, it's all in the news now. They say that the Roman Catholic Church is the greatest offender in the world when it comes to human trafficking, missing children. Everybody hear what I'm saying to you? The greatest offenders in the world. They tell me that celebrities and politicians and elitists in this nation are guilty of the most heinous crimes against children. I'm going to chase a rabbit. If he don't jump up, I'm going to make him jump. And then after I make him jump, I'm going to shoot at him. There he is. I told you I'm going to preach like it's my last revival. If I don't come back tomorrow night, I'm going to say this tonight. There is no alternative in the kingdom of God for Halloween. Hallelujah night is a farce. It's a stench in the nostrils of God. Trunk or treat. I'm telling you, folks, it's the height of idolatry to clothe that kind of junk in religious garb. Does anybody hear me? Any church that practices that ought to repent in sackcloth and ashes. There's no alternative. I don't care how you dress it up. I don't care how you dress it up. Anton LaVey said it's the one night that the church celebrates their night. Y'all okay? Now I'll say it again. I'll move on. If you follow all the debauchery, that's what Adam leaped off into. That's what Adam caused. Now, I could get in some other stuff, stuff you already know, things you've already heard preachers say, you've already heard me say in times gone by. But I think that's probably enough of that first Adam. I'm going to talk about that last Adam just a little bit. I told you that what God did in that garden was a preview of a coming attraction. God gave Adam and Eve a glimpse of what would be. They were living at the beginning of the world and the beginning of time. He gave them a glimpse of what would come at the end of the world and at the end of time. Anybody hear what I'm saying? Listen, Eve herself was a type of a coming bride. And Sarah and Rebecca and Rachel were a type of a coming bride. And Ruth was a type of a coming bride. The last Adam, he too would refuse to abandon his bride. But he'd also refuse something else. He wouldn't step off into sin with her. He said that Satan hath come and he's found nothing in me. Shout with me. Jesus said, I do always those things that please him. You hear what I'm telling you? Jesus came into this world, but he would not leap into sin with his bride. When Adam was presented his bride, she was gathered from the earth, collected from the ground. God put all that together, breathed into it. When Adam woke up and saw her, couldn't believe his eyes. When his bride was presented to him, she'd been gathered from the earth. She was whole. She was healthy. She was wise. And she was beautiful. When the last Adam came, there was no bride presented to him. Because that first bride had sinned and went back to the earth. The second Adam had to recollect a bride. He had to pull a bride out of Egypt. He had to pull a bride out of Babylon. He had to guide a bride through the Red Sea and the wilderness. He had to keep a bride from burning in the fiery furnace. He had to keep a bride all night long in a den of lions. Shout with me, somebody. He had to pull his bride from the earth again. Having done that, he had to unify that bride. All the parts had to come together. And Paul said, till we come to the fullness. I can't even remember how it goes now. I thought I had it. The fullness of the measure of the stature of Christ. That's what his bride's gonna look like when it's finished. If it don't look like that, it ain't his bride. Shout with me, somebody. What I'm trying to tell you, because she sinned and went back to the dust, when that last Adam came, he had to regather her from all of that death and all of that sin. And now he's got to make her into his image. Listen, folks, that first Eve was made like Adam. But I'm telling you that last bride is going to be made morally like the last Adam. Going to be made morally like that Christ. Shout with me, somebody. Listen, folks, she didn't have, except for her will, she had nothing to keep her. Except the fact that God said, thou shalt not. But this last bride, not only pulled from the earth, not only made in the image of him, but he sent the Holy Ghost to live inside that bride and turn the light back on. Does anybody hear me? Turned the light back on. And he had to become wisdom to her. That first Eve, that first bride, God gave her wisdom. This last bride, Christ, is made unto us wisdom. He is our wisdom. Won't stay here long because it'll make most folks nervous. If you read that Old Testament, you'll find a line where the Bible mentions the beauty of holiness. If you folks have followed me, you know I believe in a standard. I believe in a standard. I believe in decency. I believe in men being gentlemen and women being ladies. I believe all that. But when that Old Testament mentions the beauty of holiness, it ain't talking about no dress code. I ain't discounting that, please understand me. But it ain't talking about no dress code. It ain't talking about whether a man has or doesn't have facial hair. Length of clothes. I tell you, know people call preachers clothesline preachers. I said, ain't enough clothes on most lines to make a sermon. Be the shortest sermon on record. Everybody with me? But when the Bible mentions the beauty of holiness, it ain't talking about a standard or a code or a clothesline. I'll tell you what it's talking about. It's talking about Christ. He is the beauty of holiness. And I'm telling you, when he gathers his bride, makes her in his image, becomes wisdom to her, what makes her beautiful is the fact that Christ gives her her life. Paul said, in him we live, we move, we have our being. Isn't it a beautiful thing when you don't have to tell folks how to dress? Isn't it a beautiful thing when you don't have to tell them how to talk? Isn't it a beautiful thing when you don't have to tell them what to watch, what to listen to? The beauty of holiness will make you what God expects of you. Well, that last Adam would not jump into sin with his bride. Tell you what he did do, though. He became sin who knew no sin. All the sins prior to his coming, all the sins after his coming, the sins of the world were placed on him. They were so heavy that in the Garden of Gethsemane, he fell on his face, exceeding sorrowful, very heavy, prayed and agonized until blood came through his pores like sweat. Hematidrosis, one or the other, both, I don't know. I'm just reading behind some. All I'm telling you, folks, is that the weight of sin was so heavy. He wouldn't tell a lie, but he took the sin and the guilt of the liar upon himself. He wouldn't be a homosexual, but he took the sin and the guilt of the homosexual upon himself. He wouldn't steal. Come on, somebody. He wouldn't commit adultery. He wouldn't be a pervert. He wouldn't be a fornicator, but he died between an astonished heaven and a trembling earth with the weight of the sin of the world upon him. You know what he's doing, folks? He didn't jump into sin with his bride the way Adam did. He became sin that he might bring his bride out of sin. Somebody shout with me. And I don't know whether to run or stand here and take it. That first bride ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And when she did, she knew sin. There's another garden. I'm sorry, another tree in that garden. It was called the tree of life on the planet and in that garden. And to keep Adam's fallen bride and Adam himself away from that tree of life, God placed a cherubim and a flaming sword that turned every direction. For a long time, Brother Hutt, I thought it just turned like this. I didn't know I was such a dummy. That ain't every direction. The Bible said it turned every direction. Here's what I want you to notice, folks. That first bride that fell, she ate of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil. And that same devil that lured her into that failure would have led her to that tree alive, because he knew if she eats of that, she'll live forever. But God was not going to let her eat of both trees. So we put a cherubim there and a flaming sword that turned every direction in time. Listen to me. In time, God took that tree off the planet altogether. I'm telling you, it's in the heavenly somewhere. And there's going to come a day when the bride of the last Adam is going to eat from that tree alive. We're going to live forever. Somebody give him glory in this house. Do you lift your hands and praise him one more time in this house of God? Hallelujah. I never saw that first tree. I don't know what kind of fruit was on that first tree. I'm not interested in that first tree. He that overcometh will eat of the tree of life. That's the tree I'm waiting for, folks. I said, that's the tree I'm waiting for. I wouldn't give you a buffalo nickel for the first one, but I'll die to eat of the second. Well, that first tree for sure killed. But that last tree makes alive. That last Adam refused to sink with his bride. But he has been to the depths to gather every person that wants to be a part of his bride. Can't nobody but God do it. Preacher was preaching one time and talking about having women in your church that could sing but wouldn't sing. And he said, go get Nellie. Nellie's out yonder in a bar, sitting on a bar stool, drinking a Tom Collins. He said, but go get Nellie. Go get Nellie and get Nellie saved. Go get Nellie and get Nellie sanctified. Go get Nellie and get Nellie full of the Holy Ghost. He said, Nellie can sing. He said, now all I'm trying to tell you folks is God Almighty will not sink to the depths of sin and become a sinner like his bride. But what he will do, he'll step into the lowest hell and to the deepest mire, and he'll pull out for himself a jewel to make up his bride. I feel the Holy Ghost in this house tonight. Paul took his brush, started painting, painted an ugly picture. He dealt with adulterers, painted it, and idolaters. The worst of the worst, the lowest of the low, and pointed at the church and said, but such were some of you. But he didn't stop painting. You're washed. You're sanctified. You're justified. You might as well help me. I'm in this thing too deep to stop now. What I'm trying to tell you, folks, he won't join me in my sin, but he'll step into the arena of sin and pull me out if I want to be delivered from sin. Saw this video the other day. Little Canadian guy had a bucket or two of paint, and there's a wall over there. And he kicked both of those buckets of paint and kicked the paint against the wall. And what looked like what the old timers used to call a gob molly, he went over there and started stroking. When he finished, it's a tiger. And you could hardly tell where the wall ended and the vegetation behind it began. Here's what I'm trying to tell you. He ain't going to get into that sin and sin with me. But when he finishes with me, brother, he's going to make something beautiful out of something absolutely ugly and chaotic. Shout with me, who but God can do such things as these? When it's all over. When it's all over, We will, the bride of that last Adam, will be presented faultless before the Father. We will be pure, chaste, and holy. I don't know how he's going to do this, but without spot, without wrinkle, without blemish, or any such thing. I can't explain it to you. I wish I was an orator and a wordsmith and an elocutionist. I wish I could say it the way I'd love to. God only gave that to a few people, and I ain't one of them. I can't explain it to you. But I'm going to tell you, folks, on the day when that bride is presented, Jesus will not have to bow his head in shame. I took all of this time to tell you, he refuses to abandon his bride. Brother Clendenin said that he got a call one night, recognized the voice. It was one of two sons of a woman that had attended his church. She's a poor lady, godly woman. And her boys were walking devils. By this time, the time this boy calls Brother Clendenin, and the other brother may be dead. But he recognized that boy's voice. That boy's mama had to move away because when she went to the hospital, they had pawned everything she had, sold it all for drugs and alcohol, that kind of stuff. She was poor, didn't have anything, so she had to go live with family that would take care of her. Well, the guy said to Brother Clendenin, "This is so-and-so." Brother Clendenin said, "I know who you are." Said Brother Clendenin, "Brother Clendenin, I need prayer. I need you to pray with me. Pray for me." Brother Clendenin said he just prayed a prayer to get rid of him. Brother Clendenin went to a 5:30 prayer meeting about every morning, especially every weekday morning at his church. Said he walked in, I believe, his fellowship hall at the time, and said he walked over the corner where he usually prays, prayed, and he knelt down. About the first thing he said to God was, he said, "Oh God, let me see me the way you see me." And God said, "I'll be glad to." Brother Clendenin said he knew something was wrong. And he said, God spoke to him and said, "I see that you are a man who thinks you know better than I know." Brother Clendenin said, "What do you mean, Lord?" God said, "I had a man call you last night for help. And you concluded he didn't need no help. You really didn't pray for him." Brother Clendenin said his heart broke. He said he began repenting and crying. He said, "God, if you'll forgive me." He said, "I'll never do that again as long as I live." You know what Brother Clendenin said? He said, "I meant that so much that if the devil called me needing help, I'd help him." He said, "Needing help." He said, "If the devil called needing help." He said, "I meant what I said to God." He said, "I'd help him." But the first thing he said to God was, "Let me see me the way you see me." Do you know why it is sometimes God will come into your prayer chamber and everything dries up and God begins to show you and me things about us we don't want to see? He begins to say things we don't want to hear. I'll tell you why that is. It's because he refuses to abandon his bride. We're not in heaven with the doors locked, and we're not perfected yet. And God will come into my prayer time and into your prayer time, and he'll show you things about you and me, things about me, because he refuses to abandon his bride. Sister, if you come play, I'll try to shut up. I'm going to make a risky move here. Pastor said earlier about that song, if I don't light your fire, your wood's wet. If God never interrupts your prayer time, or any time to show you things about you that aren't like him, you ain't got no wood. Anybody hear what I'm saying to you? Why is it everybody wants everybody to say only good about him? Sent 7 letters. One to each of the 7 churches of Asia Minor mentioned in the Revelation. Only 2 of them. He didn't have anything bad to say. You see, every church was not Philadelphia. I have somewhat against you. You say you're rich, increased with goods, have need of nothing. But I'm telling you, you're poor, blind, miserable, wretched, naked. God will send the bride a letter. This is what you say. This is what I see. He will not abandon his bride. Said one church, I even know where Satan's seat is. But he will not abandon his bride. I pray a lot. Maybe you do too. Search me, O God, know my heart, try me, know my thoughts, and see if there be any wicked way in me. Lead me in the way everlasting. If you happen to be here tonight and you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior, got a few things against you. Number one, you have time against you. Time is running out. The other thing against you is this. God said, my spirit will not always strive with man. The other risk is that God will stop calling before you run out of time. It's possible. May not, he may not do that, but it's possible. But all that I'm saying to you is this. God won't abandon. He refuses to abandon his bride. But if she's blatant, if she keeps saying, I've washed my feet, how shall I defile them? I've taken off my coat, how shall I put it on? He'll leave myrrh at that door and walk away. No, he ain't abandoning her. She has rejected him. That is not the same thing. If you're here tonight, you don't know Jesus as your personal Lord and Savior. Now, there ain't nobody here tonight needs privacy. I maintain that folks can sin in public, they repent in public. I'm not trying to secure privacy for anybody, but I would love for this church to bow your heads and pray. I feel convicting power in this house tonight. The atmosphere to me feels charged. I believe somebody here tonight's been drawn by the Holy Ghost. I want the church just to pray with me, please. Please pray. Pray that people won't harden their hearts against this last Adam, that they'll not refuse to become a part of his bride. You don't know Jesus tonight, you're in this house, lost in sin and headed to a godless eternity. Taking this time, ask the church to pray for you and to give you this invitation. If you don't know Jesus, would you consider getting out of your seat and getting in these altars tonight and giving him a chance to wash you, cleanse you, purge you, and make you a part of the bride? But Brother Jones, you don't know how bad my life is. I know, but he does. And he's still calling you. He's still inviting you, Brother Jones. You don't know. You don't know where I've been, but he does. Brother Jones, there are things I can't even tell my parents. Yeah, but God already knows. You don't have to tell him. He already knows. If you're lost here tonight, he'll not jump into sin with you. But Christ has already become sin for you and died for your sins. I wonder if you'd come get out of your seat and come tonight. I'm preaching like it's my last revival, and I'm giving this invitation like it's my last revival. When this house lost without God would raise your hand and say, "Preacher, I'm unsaved and I need this Jesus you talked about last night." Would you raise your hand? You can take it right back down. Anybody in this assembly, you'd raise your hand. "I do not know Jesus as personal Savior. I do not belong to his bride." Anybody? 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 Stand with me all over this house, would you please? I'm going to ask you to do this. I will say this, if you need to put on a mask to feel safe, then do that. But could we fill these altars tonight? The door of grace is about to close. We have family on their way to hell tonight. We have family members that may be a breath away from eternity. I wonder if you'd let's turn this sanctuary into an altar tonight. I have sons headed to hell while I'm preaching to you about this salvation. Would you let's lay hold of God tonight? We might want to start out by saying, "God, let me see me the way you see me." Deal with that and then begin to pray for lost loved ones, would you? He refused to abandon his bride, and he's still reaching tonight. He's reaching into the darkest corners of our cities and the darkest corners of our countries. God wants to save lost humanity. Would you let's pray tonight? Would you let's pray tonight? There is no corner so remote. There is no place so dark or polluted that he won't go. Turn the light on and bring men out of sin. He wants to save our families tonight. He wants to sanctify believers. He wants to fill the sanctified with the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. Let's pray all over this house with you. Start with us, oh God. Start with your church. Start with your bride tonight in the name of Jesus. Maybe they'll sing something. Let's just believe God to move among us the way he moved among those seven golden candlesticks.
What do you say? a fountain filled with blood that flows from Emmanuel's veins, and sinners plunge beneath the flood, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, lose all their guilty stains, and sinners plunge beneath.
Anybody need special prayer, we'd be happy to pray over you. Some are still in these altars talking to God. That's wonderful. But if you have special need for prayer, you'd like for us to anoint you, we'd be happy to do that tonight.
All my sins away, washed all my sins away, and there may I go.
Thank you.
search for answers in this ever-changing world. Solutions to the problems that you face. And I am here to tell you, you can find the answers here, 'cause they're only found in God's amazing grace. Though the blood still cleanses hearts of sin, it still delivers fallen man. It has never lost its power to save. No, the blood hasn't ever changed.
We still believe that the blood works. They say there's nothing to the word of God, but there will come a day
from your burden of sin. There's power in blood, power in the blood. Would your evil of victory win? There's wonderful power in the blood. Whiter, much whiter than snow. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Sin stains are lost in its life-giving flow. There's wonderful power in the blood. There is power, oh power, oh wonder-working power in the blood. Service for Jesus, your King. There's power in the blood, power in the blood. Would you live daily His praises to sing? There's wonderful power in the blood.
There is power, power, oh wonder-working power.
There is power, be as clay to the potter, may I be to thee. You may have to break down resistance at times, but Lord, don't stop molding and shaping my life. Take me, dear Father, please make me like you. Mold me completely so I can be true. And if you have to break me, may I understand you're still loving and molding my life in your hand. It would be such disservice, results would be nil. Rejects potter and seeks its own will, it would only be cast out to the old potter's field. Please don't cast me out, Master. Put me back on your Father. Please make me like you. Hold me completely so I can be true. And if you have to break me, may I understand you're still loving. Thank you.
good to you tonight.
God is so good.
Hallelujah.
God is so good.
He's so good to me. He cares for me. I love him. Would you help me love him?
And
I love him so. I love you, Jesus. I love him so. Oh, I love him so. He's so good to me. Would you do that one more time? Answers prayer, and he answers prayer. He answers prayer. Oh, now he answers prayer. He's so good to me. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. There ain't nobody can do you like Jesus. You know, he said we have not because we ask not. He also said ask and ye shall receive. Seek and ye shall find, knock and it shall be opened unto you. I'm glad he's not too busy to hear our cry. Not too busy. We live in a busy society. People are running everywhere. But Jeremiah 33:3 says, call upon me. I will answer you, show you great and mighty things that thou knowest not. Anybody glad he loves his bride? Anybody glad he didn't abandon us there and call 12 legions of angels there while he was on the cross bearing our sin? But he went all the way. Every step he took, he did it for me. He did it for you. What a love. What a love. My, my. Hallelujah. 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 Thank you, Jesus. Brother John. Hallelujah. 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 Hallelujah.
For making me whole.
There's still needs here tonight. God's able to meet them.
Thank you, Lord.
In Jesus and to take him at his word, just to know that thou art with me, will be with me till the end. Jesus, Jesus, how I trust him, how I prove him. Hallelujah, hallelujah. Praise the Lord. Brother Andrew just rejoicing in what the Lord's done tonight. I believe one of his co-workers was marvelously saved tonight. Ain't that wonderful? Praise God. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. The angels in heaven, the Bible said, are rejoicing more over that one. that got saved, and over the 99 that are whole that need not a physician. Come on, somebody help me tonight. You know, we don't need to lose our focus there. Now, you know that one that say we need to be praying for them to be discipled and go and become a witness for Christ. Hallelujah. She's getting in on the 11th hour. That hour's about over. You know, that's the last hour. You don't see 12 where he sends them out at 12. No, that's when he calls. Amen. He sends them out the 11th hour, but not the 12th. We're in that 11th hour. Praise God. It's almost ended, though. Hallelujah. He has not given us a spirit of fear, but of love and power and a sound mind. Hallelujah. Fear. Come on, somebody help me. Fear has torment. It'll torment you. But he said, my peace I give unto you, not as the world gives, a peace. Peace, peace, peace. You know, it don't even seem as late as it is. I believe it's almost like we just got to church and we need to start all over again. Hallelujah, praise God. I know you got to tell somebody about it tomorrow. You know, it's too good to keep to yourself. You know, some folks there, you know, those four lepers, they went there and said, well, I sit here till we die. And then they went in that city in there and they got to taking it all for themselves. And then they got to thinking, now this ain't going to be good. We don't need to keep all this here. We need to go tell that city there what it is. And they went and told them. There was one feller in that city didn't believe there what the prophet said going to happen the next day. You know what happened to him, don't you? Huh. Poor feller. Said, yeah, I believe we're going to do this. If he opened up the windows of heaven, Elijah said, you'll see it tomorrow, but you won't partake of it. And they trampled over him. They went down in there. They were eating donkey's dung and donkey's head and dove's dung, all that there. But that next day, oh, God opened up the windows of heaven and they had themselves a feast. Praise God. You know, if you just keep holding on, God will give the victory. He will. You know what? There's a song that's entitled, Don't Give Up on the Brink of a Miracle. Maybe you've been praying for somebody. I'm closing. You've been praying for somebody, for God to save somebody, and you ain't been praying like you were at one time. Don't give up on that one. Don't give up on your miracle. It is but a light thing for him. The centurion said, I ain't worthy for you to come in my house. Come to where I'm at. But if you'll speak the word, you'll just speak the word. That's all he's got to do. Peter said to him when on that boat, when he's walking on the water, said, Lord, bid me to come to you. All Jesus said was come. Now, I don't read there that he laid out no board for him to walk on. He just stepped out of the boat and he walked on the water. He'd have stayed on the water if he hadn't got his eyes off of Jesus. So don't get your eyes off of him. Let's look to the Lord tonight. God bless you. Thank you so much for coming. Thank you, Brother Donnie, Sister Rihanna, for coming. They had to go around because there was a wreck somewhere or another, and they had to detour around there, but it was worth it. Worth it. Thank you for coming tonight. Brother Jeremy's here with us there, and he got a break tonight where he could worship. He needs a break every once in a while there, but we don't want to let him have too many breaks. We don't want to let him have too many breaks. Praise the I tell you what, Brother Jacob, he'll put the icing on the cake. He just knows how to do it. Amen. Let's stand and be dismissed in prayer here tonight. Just so glad, thankful to have you here with us tonight. Amen. What was that? Oh, yeah, if I was going to miss any night, I wouldn't miss tomorrow night. Amen. I wouldn't miss it. Amen. Amen. Praise the Lord. Brother Peden, would you dismiss us in prayer?